Center. My name is Don Schalk, and I'm a member of the business faculty and director of the MBA program here. It's our privilege today to have the eighth year of our executive in residence program, and our executive this year is Wendy Yuengling, so why don't we give her a warm welcome. And before we start, just to recognize a couple of folks in the audience, our president, Glynis Fitzgerald. Provost, Dr. Limor Kahan. Associate Provost, Mary Ellen Wells. Executive Vice President, Gayton Giannini. And Tom Minnick, who is a member of our IA group. Also, can our faculty that's here please stand up to be recognized?
They're in the back, so all right, thank you. So today, you know, as we go through this presentation, feel free to write down your questions. Those of my students who ask one will automatically get extra credit, so do that. But let's start first, Wendy. Tell us a little bit about your role at Yuengling, as well as a little bit of background and history about Yuengling.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Wendy Yuengling. I am sixth generation in our family business. I work alongside my dad and my three sisters every day, so that's fun. And I joined the company in 2004, so almost 20 years ago. But I was a marketing major sitting in a seat like yours. I graduated and I worked outside of the business probably for the first 8 years, just getting established in my career. I started in market research, learned a little bit about that part of the business, and then moved over into more creative outlet. And I worked in advertising for a few years before I joined Yuengling. And when I joined, I was not living in Pennsylvania, so the only outlet for me to get involved in the family business was through sales. So that was my first venture into sales, which was very eye-opening, great opportunity for anybody to learn and build self-confidence and get more comfortable in front of people. And I did that for about 2 years before we moved back to Pennsylvania. And that's when I finally started working in marketing for the brewery. I did that for about 2 years. And then at that point, I knew I was committed to the family business long term. So I built out my own sort of career path development plan where I worked in every department of the company. So for the next 2 years, I worked in operations. And I learned a little bit about brewing, enough to be dangerous. I learned about packaging, logistics, supply chain, accounting, and then I spent the next 2 years in administration. So pulling together the financial side, IT, human resources, which I knew nothing about. And I've landed in the role of chief administrative officer now with the family business. And I get to kind of pull all that together and, you know, every day work for something that I feel extremely passionate about. So it's been really fun.
Yeah, Yuengling is, I believe, the oldest brewery in the United States. And what's interesting, as you mentioned, is you're the sixth generation. And research shows in a family-oriented business that of you that make it to the sixth generation, only 3% survive. So why is that? Tell us a little bit about the culture at, and core values of Yuengling.
Sure. If you look, the average lifespan of a company is about 20 years, 21 years, in fact. So for a company to make it to 195 years, well, we're 194, we'll be 195 next year. That's monumental. And, you know, I attribute it to the fortitude, the hard work, perseverance, and in some ways loyalty of the previous generations who were committed to the business and were committed to Pennsylvania. We've been rooted in Pottsville for 194 years. My great-great-great-grandfather started it basically by following the water source up into an area where he could build a business. and we've been there ever since. And we have two breweries in Pottsville now. We have one in Tampa, Florida, and we distribute in 26 states. And I think part of the key to success is there's always been somebody that wanted to keep the family business going. Our greatest period of growth has been under my dad's term. So he started with the brewery. Well, he's always worked for the brewery for as long as, you know, he could walk and talk. It's been in his blood. But he bought the company in 1985 from my grandfather. And that really started the growth period that we've been on. And that's when we built breweries, expanded into new markets. And he's always maintained sort of a underdog mentality. And so we've always tried to do things with less. We've always been a very gritty organization. We don't have a lot of layers. We're not corporate America. And I think that is a big part of our culture now. We're very much a family company. And my dad and my sisters and I are all very hands-on in the business, more so than most people realize. And we have, you know, very good relationships with employees. We have employees that are multi-generational like us. And I think a lot of that is because of the loyalty that they see and that they believe in. But also people genuinely are passionate about what the company stands for. We're American-owned, family-operated, and I think that resonates with a lot of people.
So on top of that then, what's the difference in your view between a family business and one that's publicly traded? And has Yuengling ever thought about going public?
I don't think we would ever go public as long as it's my dad and my sisters and I involved, because then you're answering to Wall Street and you're answering to stockholders, shareholders, and that's just not the way we run. My dad is very entrepreneurial. We have always prided ourselves in being able to do things that make the most sense long term. They might not always be favorable decisions short term. And so when you're answering to investors, that's a hard thing to do, but that's always been our guide, is what's best for the business long term.
Yeah, I would agree with that. I worked for several family businesses, and I think the advantage of working for a company like that is their capital is patient, and they're not worried about their stock price every 90 days, so they're not making short-term decisions. So, good. Thank you for sharing that. What are your traits? What do you look at as the traits of a good leader?
I would say, first and foremost, a good leader is somebody that is trustworthy. In my experience, it's somebody that has humility and self-awareness. You meet a lot of people with egos, and from what I've seen, they are not the strongest at building relationships. And I think a good leader needs to build good relationships, particularly with their team, to be able to influence and motivate. And I think leaders who rely on their team, are open to input, recognize their team, and give them part of the credit when things are going well, I think those are ones that inspire others.
I noticed in your reading your bio and doing a little research that when you went to the brewery, you actually worked almost in every function of the brewery. You know, and as a leader, how did that impact you, and do you believe that that helps you make better decisions if you understand how the business totally functions?
I feel like it absolutely does for me. We were talking about it earlier. Like, I did that out of necessity to try and find my place in the family company and figure out what part of the business I was drawn to, but I think it helped me, one, build relationships across the organization. So not just with managers, but guys that are running machines and our brewers and people that are forklift drivers loading beer for our distributors. It was nice to be able to forge a lot of those relationships. And you just learn a lot about why decisions are made. When you're siloed in one part of the company, you don't always understand the why of why something happens. And that gave me that 360 understanding of the business.
Yeah, I would, you know, in my career, basically, I did that, as that took that tract as well. You know, and I think students, you know, a lot of times when you graduate here, it's okay to start at an entry-level position, and if you aspire to a management position, you really want to understand how the business works. You can't go from, very rarely will you go into a management position to start, and you'll be better off if you do as Wendy just mentioned, in developing your career, and will end up ultimately being a better leader when you do that. So today, what trends in business today are impacting Yuengling right now?
For us, I would say consumer tastes are changing. During our 190 years, we've had to continue adapt to meet consumer tastes, and you've seen that over the years. You know, I don't know how familiar you are with our industry, but in the 70s, you know, light beers were just being developed, and now they're over 40% of beer sales. In the 80s was the rise of craft, and so people were interested in different styles of beer, different colors, more character, and that really helped catapult our brand lager. And now you're seeing consumers that are more concerned with what they're putting into their body. And so in 2020, we developed a better for you type of beer, lower carb, lower calorie, better stats. We call it the next generation of light beer. It's our flight. And so you're trying to develop products that stay relevant with consumers, but you know, tastes are changing rapidly. Not everyone's drinking beer anymore. People are interested in seltzers and FMBs, and non-alcs and low alcohol beverages are becoming more popular. So that's definitely a trend that we watch and we try to adapt to, like we've been doing all these years.
When, you know, with that in mind, how does Yuengling go about developing new products or changing its product mix?
Yeah, we're not necessarily a company that's known for innovation. You know, a lot of breweries will introduce new beers multiple times a year, and we are very grounded in our core brands, and we've always been that way, and we've had select innovation over the years where we feel like we can have big gains, and that was sort of the genesis with our flight, and a few years before that we developed a golden pilsner. But I would say R&D typically starts around marketing and seeing where there's an opportunity for us in our portfolio. And then our brewers go to work and they try and develop something that is distinctly Yuengling, has character, is authentic to us as, you know, a traditional German family. And once we have the liquid, we start to work on the brand identity, the name. We'll do some market research, but a lot of it is us knowing the business, tapping into our distributor partners for input, and asking consumers. We get a ton of visitors to our brewery up in Pottsville and now down in Tampa. So asking customers what's important to them and what resonates with them. And so that's sort of our R&D process, which is really fun when we have a project like that to work on. Hershey Chocolate Porter was probably the most recent one. We partnered with Hershey and developed the liquid and developed the brand and developed the marketing strategy, and that excites people.
Two other trends that companies today struggle with is one, labor. You know, if you look at that trend and the difficulty of finding labor today, how do you address that issue? How do you recruit employees? How do you retain them?
We almost have two different strategies. We are very lucky with our breweries in Pennsylvania and even in Florida. We have a very loyal workforce and we have very low turnover. And I think we attribute it to the fact that people are treated like family, you offer good benefits, you know, you're just very understanding of scheduling. It's been more challenging, probably on the sales side, getting younger folks in on the marketing side. There's just a lot more turnover. People will come in, work for a couple years, and then move on to the next thing where, you know, generations before, when they started with a company, they stayed there. So we definitely have to be more creative in our recruiting process and selling who we are as a company. And I think the fact that we are authentic and we've stayed true to who we are as an American company and a family company, you find people where that resonates with, and that's been very helpful for us.
Do you have an intern program?
We don't have a formal one. We've done a few internships over the years, and it honestly, oftentimes it ends up being employees, kids that are in college that want to get some credit for either marketing, or we've had folks in the lab doing quality if they're going to school for chemistry or biology. So we've found that there is definitely opportunity in that. We've also found that it's a lot to manage that, and we don't run with a lot of, but we run very lean, so it's been hard for us to do, but every year we do a few, and it's been very, very helpful.
The, you know, one of the other issues that COVID brought to light was the whole supply chain issue. Was that an issue for Yuengling? And, you know, since COVID is over, is that changed? Did it force you to make any significant changes in your supply chain?
We definitely experienced it like most companies did. I would say that we have had such long-standing relationships with a lot of our vendors where we were covered, but I know we ran, you know, hand to mouth with cans and certain packaging materials because everybody was struggling to keep up. We have been able to get through it okay. In part because we've had good relationships with so many of these vendors. You know, our label manufacturer has been printing labels for us for as long as, you know, going back to my grandfather. So that definitely helps us. And there's been, you know, over the years, there's been so much consolidation with our suppliers. So you don't necessarily have another option. So that is something that we keep a close eye on.
Let's kind of switch gears to kind of the future of work. You know, how is technology impacting Yuengling, and in what ways?
If you take a step back and look at it, technology is pretty much woven into everything that we do. But at the same time, brewing beer is a craft, and selling beer is about relationships. So it will never replace that. It certainly supports our equipment automation and helps with supply chain scheduling, and, you know, it really runs the back end of our operation. But in terms of going forward, you know, AI is very popular with a lot of companies, and you haven't seen a significant adoption of AI in the manufacturing industry yet. I think you're starting to with scheduling, preventative maintenance, and even on the marketing side. You know, you can use AI to develop a brand, develop packaging, develop a campaign. For us, though, I think that we still rely on people who know the brands, understand our company and culture, and, you know, eventually we always adapt to how industry trends are changing, and technology is no different. But, you know, AI doesn't play a big role in what we do right now.
The, you know, to the students, I think one of the things that you're going to want to understand is AI, because by the time some of you graduate, AI will have an impact on the future of work with a lot of companies, a lot of different functions and all that. So as Wendy says, in a lot of cases, it still hasn't built itself into companies and how they do business yet, but I think it's just a matter of time before it does that. Robotics, do you use robotics at all at the...
We do. So a job that back in the 80s took several men to do was our keg line. So it took several guys to be able to cap the keg, push it off onto pallets, and load it for trucks. And now all of that is automated in our system. So we have two robots at Mill Creek that do all of our kegging, taking them full off the line and loading them onto pallets and taking the empties off the pallets and putting them back on the line. We have two robots down in Tampa that do the same thing, and they're very reliable.
Do you anticipate, again, with the labor situation, that robotics will even become more important to you as the population ages and such?
When I think about brewing, I don't necessarily know that robotics can take the place of the guys that are working a brew through start to finish and adding the ingredients. You know, there might be some opportunities on packaging, but again, we don't have a lot of guys on machines, and so maybe there'll be opportunity down the road, but I don't see it short term.
So when you go home at the end of the day, and after you put the kids to bed, what keeps you up at night?
Oh, that's a good question. You know, so much has changed in our business from when I joined in 2004, and we were selling beer in 9 states, and we had just built our brewery and our second brewery in Pottsville, and we had just purchased a third brewery in Tampa. You know, fast forward to now, and we're selling beer in 26 states. We recently established a partnership to be able to expand further west, so now we're also producing out in Texas. So managing all of that, and we added a new facility down in Tampa, right in front of our Tampa brewery, which is a new venture for us into the food and beverage industry. So we've built this brand experience destination down in Tampa, which has been really exciting, and it opened in June, and you know, it's not something we've ever done before. We've always made beer, and so we are learning the hospitality side of the business. So between all that, there's a lot more complexity in our company now than there was 20 years ago, and so it could be any number of things that, you know, are weighing on my mind at night.
You know, when you look to hire employees, what do you look for in them? What key skills do you look for in employees?
For us, the one thing that you can't teach, and I'm sure this applies to a lot of companies, but the one thing you can't teach is passion. And you can teach skills. You can teach somebody the beer industry. You can teach them how to sell. But when we find someone with good interpersonal skills that has true passion for working for America's oldest brewery, those are the people we're drawn to.
So basically, are you saying that when you look at employees, that the people skills and their ability to communicate and write is probably more important than the technical side?
I would agree with that, absolutely. You can teach them anything that's skill related, but to be able to have the have the ability to work closely with others on a team, have the interpersonal skills, the communication skills, the self-awareness, those are critical for somebody to come in and succeed. And quite honestly, those are the people that I see in our organization, at least. They tend to open up doors for themselves to better opportunities, and then they grow and develop with the organization.
So you've been out of school now for, I won't ask how long, but when you entered the workforce, what do you know now that you wish you knew when you were 21?
I think the time and experience has given me confidence. You know, when you're 21 and you're just starting out, you have a lot of nervous energy and you're trying to impress. And I think now you just have the confidence to sit back, listen, learn, ask questions. You're not trying to impress anybody anymore. And then you're just naturally building credibility.
So you're saying that listening skills and is probably critical to success. And what about the work-life balance? How do you look at, how does Yuengling, how do you look at the work-life balance?
That is something I think that I've had to learn and get better at, especially as I've started my own family. Early on, I think I was like a lot of people, you know, you just push yourself to work, and it's the most important thing in your life or in your world. But now that I have my own family, it puts things into perspective, and we pride ourselves on being a family company. So I feel like it's important for me to demonstrate that balance to others so they don't feel like they have to be on at 8 and 9 o'clock at night. Things can wait till tomorrow. It'll be there when you come back the next day. And, you know, there's always going to be times where you have to pitch in and stay late or do extra work on the weekends. But I try very hard to maintain a good balance.
The, you know, the importance, I think, of self-reflection and as well as continuous learning is a critical trait of a leader. What do you do to maintain and continuously learn? How do you do that?
Yeah, it's harder as you get busier to find time to devote to training and development for yourself. I was better about it early on in my career because I felt like I needed to keep learning. So you have to consciously take a step back. But I find that as you build your team, I like to surround myself with people and leaders that are different from me, people who think different, who make different decisions. And so I learn every day from the people that I work with, and that has been very enjoyable to me in as I've progressed in my career.
The issue of, you know, again, another trend that a lot of companies are dealing with and working at is the whole issue of diversity and inclusion and equity. How does Yuengling deal with that today?
Yeah, I mean, we're fortunate in that we have women leaders in our family, and so that becomes the narrative a lot for Yuengling. Diversity in Schuylkill County is very different from diversity in Tampa, Florida, and so we try to maintain a diverse workforce. You have to hire people who are going to do the job well. And it's something that we just continue to work on. You know, having women in the sales force is one opportunity for us, and we've gotten better over the years, but we still have a long way to go.
I mean, in the industry you're in, is it primarily male dominated? And from your perspective, has that changed? And how did when you deal with competitors and industry leaders, how did you approach that?
It is definitely a male-dominated industry, and early on, I mean, it was not uncommon for me to be the only woman in a meeting, in a room. It didn't faze me, honestly. Like, you're just in there to learn, and so I didn't think too much about it, but companies are changing. You're seeing a lot of other brewers bringing more women into the industry, and so we're making progress. But I would say, you know, compared to a lot of the major brewers out there, it's just still an opportunity for our industry.
I'm going to stop here for a second and open it up for questions. Certainly take questions from the audience. Who has a question? Yes, right there.
My question is, do you feel any, like, pressure being the sixth generation owner of the family, or of the company, I should say?
Yes.
I only ask because my family owns a business, and I just wanted to get an opinion on that.
Yeah, I think that's very natural. You do feel pressure because you have an obligation to the employees, and we take that very seriously. So we've had a good run. but you just want to make sure you continue to do right by the company. And, you know, my dad has always said this, like his goal is to keep the business strong for the next generation. And my sisters and I have taken that to heart. But yeah, it's not easy.
Yeah, I mean, when I was running organizations, you know, one of the things that I always thought of when I made a decision was that those decisions didn't only impact the employees that I had, but they impact the family members, my vendors, and all that sort of thing. So I took it very seriously. And you know, it's important that you ask questions, you know, get input from others, you know, to make a good educated decision. And I'm sure you do that as well. There was a question in the back there.
Hi, I first off wanted to say thank you for coming in today. You briefly mentioned earlier that your first role in the business was through sales, and so I'd appreciate it if you can kind of expand on some of the obstacles that you went through to kind of climb the ranks to get to where you are today.
Yeah, so I started in sales because I didn't live in Pennsylvania. I couldn't work at the brewery every day, and that was very eye-opening to me. Dealing with rejection from retailers, dealing with our distributor partners that didn't have time for Yuengling that day because they had 20 other brands they were focused on. So you learn resilience, and I think sales is a great area for students to learn resilience and confidence in their career. I forget the second part of your question.
Just basically, you know, what helped you basically climb some of the ranks to get to the position you are today?
Yeah, I think you just have to just keep going. I mean, you're going to have bad days, you're going to have bad weeks, you're going to have bad months. But if you believe in what you're doing, and it's easy for me to sit here and say that because I'm working for my family company and I take a lot of pride in that, but you just have to believe in where you're going. And I've always been one to have a plan. I know where I want to go. And if you just stay committed to that and don't let the bumps and bruises get you down, because there's a lot, and you just have to keep fighting.
Yeah, thank I mean, you. I think, you know, to add to that, certainly persistence, dealing with adversity is critical. Not being afraid to fail, because none of us will get out of here without having some failure. And it's a matter of, do you decide to quit and give up, or do you kind of just keep pushing forward? And you know, those are traits of people that generate success in business or whatever endeavor they choose. So any other question? Another question?
Hi, I'm Nick. My question would be, talking about failure, what's the biggest failure been for you when you were at Yuengling, and how did you handle it?
I think, like Don said, you can't be afraid of failure, because when you do, you ultimately learn from it every time, and you don't want to make the same mistake twice. I would say, I mean, there's been various things I've been involved with that didn't necessarily work out. We've pushed for things that didn't necessarily align with what was comfortable for the company, and so I've learned a lot from that. But I think you have to be willing to try new things, and so I don't regret any of it. I feel like you have to be willing to keep pushing the envelope to stay relevant. I don't know if that explained your question well, but.
Well, I mean, to add to that too, you learn more from failure than you do from success, you know, and you have to look at it that way. And, you know, again, not being afraid to fail. If you never fail, you didn't learn anything, right? You know, so yeah, I think you have to look at it like that as well.
And you have to be willing to push yourself outside your comfort zone. And that's, you know, if you're truly committed to growing in your career, like, think about what it is that pushes you outside of your comfort zone that's going to help you develop. And that's not easy to do. Like, some people might just be comfortable going into an office every day and never feel challenged. But if you want to really grow, you have to be willing to get uncomfortable.
Jack.
Hey, Wendy, how you doing? So a quick question. So I saw an article in the New York Post about, you know, your dad wanting more shelf space in different retailers. So, you know, as Yuengling, the America's oldest brewery, how did you guys overcome that obstacle, and what do you guys do to, you know, take over and, you know, try and get more shelf space?
Yeah, so if you look at the beer industry, we are roughly about a 2.5 share. So 97.5% of people are not picking up our brands. But we have so much opportunity, and the sales speak for themselves. And so we just have to continue pounding for our fair share of things. That's either with retailers, that's with our distributors, and just continuing to make customers aware that we're here. Most people, at least in Pennsylvania, recognize the brand, but we are such a small player compared to the major brands that are out there.
Other question? Anybody else have a question? So what advice, you know, would you have for these students? You know, knowing what you know and such, what words of wisdom can you leave them with?
I would encourage students, you know, when you leave here and you're in the workforce, be patient. We see a lot of folks entering into the business and they're ready to move on to the next thing right away. And give yourself time to learn. You know, you're not going to get into a role and in 9 to 12 months move into the next position. Like, you have to really learn. And it, you know, for me, I think it's spending 2 and 3 years in a position to really understand everything, and then you're ready to keep growing. And so I think patience is important. You know, everybody wants to grow, but you have to put your time in, you have to roll up your sleeves and work hard. And I think employers value loyalty and commitment. And, you know, that's just changed in generations. And so, you know, staying focused on what you want is a big piece of it.
All right, I have time for one last question. Anybody have a question? One last question. Yes.
They might be feeling pressured to, like you, step away from the family business or step right into it. Can you talk a little bit about your decision to not go immediately into Yuengling, if you don't mind sharing that, and then your journey back to Yuengling?
Yeah, I think that's a great question, because my path was different from my three sisters. We had this monumental family conversation when I was in college that we didn't know was so monumental at the time, but it was really our dad sitting us down and saying, hey, I need to either invest in the business if you're in it, or I need to know you're not in it for the long haul. And so three of my sisters made the commitment and said, hey, we're going to come back and start working for the brewery right out of college. I just wasn't ready for that. I wanted to apply what I've learned. I wanted to live elsewhere. I wanted to get experience and work for other people. So my journey was different from my sister's. And, you know, I think depending on your family business, there's probably not a right or wrong answer, because my dad needed us at the brewery at the time, and three of my sisters made that commitment. As I look to our next generation, you know, I personally feel very strongly that you gain so much from working for somebody else, you know, whether it's confidence, experience, understanding how different companies manage. So I think that's an important piece of an opportunity in a family business that, you know, we'll probably build into a more structured path for entry for the next generation.
Any other questions before we wrap up? So, Wendy, I'd like to thank you for your wisdom today, and students for your questions and attention. And Wendy will be back with us in the spring, and to kind of follow up a little bit more on her journey and give you a lot of thoughts to think about as you kind of move through your college education. So, with that, Let's give Wendy a great hand and thank her.
Thank you. I appreciate the opportunity. It seems like so long ago that I was sitting in your seats. It goes fast, and so I wish you all a lot of luck in your college years and into your careers.
Thank you.